Well, good evening, everyone. Give everybody just a minute or two to come in and find a seat. I trust that you've had a great Wednesday and a great start to your week. If you haven't, I hope that you have, but I hope that tonight will be the break in the week that has not been so perfect for you that we can use to enjoy each other's company, to study God's Word together, and to use that to refocus our minds and re-energize ourselves for the week ahead. Before we continue with our studies of the book of Ecclesiastes, the class Beyond the Hevel, tonight, just a couple of refreshing points. First being that, as we mentioned on Sunday afternoon, we are doing a two-part introduction and overview for the book. So tonight will be the continuation of the introduction and overview that we started on Sunday afternoon, and also the point at which we will wrap that up. So Sunday afternoon, we will begin our study of the text, or dive into the text of Ecclesiastes. So as we mentioned, it takes about an hour to read through the book. So when you want to start that for this first time, you're going to do that in the next 2 to 3 weeks. Let's try and make sure that if you're going to be here on Sunday, we read Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 1 through 11 will be our focus on this coming Sunday. But I would suggest that we just go ahead and get that first chapter out of the way and read it in its entirety, and we'll be discussing that over the next couple of class periods. Just a quick recap of what we spoke about on Sunday afternoon so we can roll into what we're going to talk about tonight, and hopefully it'll all tie together. So first, we sort of talked about the mechanisms of which I hope the class will funnel through. And then we had a discussion about the experience level, so to speak, with Ecclesiastes that everyone in this room has, or the exposure level to Ecclesiastes that we all have, and how hopefully the fact that there are some people with coming into the class that are going to have a brand new, fresh perspective on the book, and there are people who have a very seasoned perspective that came from years and years of study on the book, that we can use that to all work together to hone and refine our understanding of the text. Then we started to talk about why, or actually we talked about the term Hevel. So the term in the title of the class that we are going to focus on through the majority of our study together this quarter, the different meanings and translations. And we're going to look at that a little bit closer again at the end of class tonight, just so it'll be fresh in our minds when we actually do get into the text next week. Because as we mentioned, understanding this term is key to our understanding of this book as a whole. And then we discussed for just a few moments why it's important enough for the Holy Spirit to put this book in the Bible that we all have and believe in, and why it is important for us to study it. And we sort of came to the conclusion that this book is going to break down our foundation of what, or what, not just ours in this room, but the world, as someone who's a human in the human existence, the foundation that you have of the way that you believe life should work and the way that God should play his role in the life that you have and the way that would work. And we discussed that, and we mentioned this idea of the myth of religious fulfillment and what that meant in accordance with the way that that foundation will be prepared. Does anybody able to or willing to give a quick recap of what that concept was, what the myth of religious fulfillment was that we spoke about on Sunday afternoon? Yes, sir. Yeah.
Information that's coming to us, and we therefore are getting a false sense of peace when we want that, but what is it driving it? Because one can be artificial and one is genuine.
Right, so just to recap quickly, thank you very much. It's a sense of contentment and peace that we can get in this life when things are going well, but what happens to that sense of peace and contentment at our life when things start to fall apart? And particularly, how does that make us view the role that God plays in our life in those times? And I think, as we mentioned, Ecclesiastes is going to take a direct aim at that mindset, and we're going to see that played out throughout the quarter. So those are the things that we talked about this previous Sunday night. So let's go ahead now and have a prayer, and then we will get started with the remainder of our introduction. If you will, bow with me, please. Father, we come to you tonight so thankful for all that you have done for us. We thank you for loving us, and we love you in return, Father. We thank you so much for the opportunity specifically for us to gather here tonight and for us to do so on every Sunday and Wednesday night to study your word, in a place of safety and comfort, and to study your word together as a group. And we thank you for the revelation that you've given us. We thank you for, particularly through this quarter, the book of Ecclesiastes that we're going to be studying, and we ask that you help us to study this book in a manner that will help us to instill the things that we will see in the text in our lives so that we can ultimately live a life that's serving you the way you would have, and for us to use that life to glorify you to all of the world around us. Most of all, we thank you for Jesus, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. Okay, so we talked about all the things that we just mentioned on Sunday night. So tonight, we're going to talk about the authorship of the book, which we briefly started to touch on Sunday night before I had to awkwardly stop class to make sure that I fulfilled the promise that I made to everyone that we would be done within 15 seconds of the first bell. So we're going to revisit the few points that we talked about there and then continue our discussion on authorship. Then we're going to discuss the fact that Ecclesiastes is part of the collection of the wisdom literature and the role that it plays within the wisdom literature and sort of the function of the wisdom literature as a whole. Then we will revisit the topic of Hevel, and then we will just talk about a couple of minor class goals to wrap up our time together tonight. So, back to this subject of authorship. First, let me just say that we're going to have a discussion that's going to revolve around the different possibilities of authorship and different variations of a couple of them. And it's never explicitly stated in the book, at least to my understanding, who the author is. And so before we have this conversation, I just want everyone to know that ultimately, whatever decision that we come to, or you come to, or I come to, that the most important thing is that we all understand, and that you understand that this is what I believe is the most important thing, is that Ecclesiastes is part of God's inspired word. It is inspired by the Holy Spirit and put in the Bible in that context. I don't want you to think that because we're going to have this conversation on the authorship of the book, while I do believe that the authorship of the book helps us have a certain perspective, I don't believe that the authorship of the book is a sticking point in any way to be trifled over. So, who did we say last week is traditionally attributed to being the author of Ecclesiastes? Solomon, right. And then we took a look at the beginning of Ecclesiastes, verses 1 through 3. And we read these words, the words of the preacher, the son of David, king in Jerusalem, vanity of vanities, says the preacher, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. What does man gain by all the toil which he toils under the sun? And I've mentioned to you that it strikes me that there's a shift in writing style, in perspective there, a shift from the first person speaking about the preacher in third person to then the words of the preacher popping off the page, starting in what is verse 3, where what does man gain by all the toil at which he toils under the sun? And we mentioned that we see this transition back in the last half of the book, or the last half of the last chapter of the book in Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 9 and 10, where after that verse 2, and we began with verse 3 of chapter 1, and we had this shift to now telling the story of the words of the preacher or the teacher. It says, besides being wise, the preacher, so we're shifting back here, also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. So it seems to me that at this point, one possibility is, yes, Solomon is the author of Ecclesiastes, because it's without question within his capability to refer to himself in the first and the third person, especially for the works, a literary work such as this. But it also, at least in my mind, leans to the possibility that, as we mentioned on Sunday night, that it's someone else telling the story of the preacher. And I do need to make an apology. Sunday night, I referenced The Princess Bride, and I said it was about Princess Sweet Pea, I believe. It's Princess Buttercup. And I got told that before I left the grounds on Sunday night. So if you are also a diehard Princess Bride fan, I apologize to you. But regardless of that, it does seem to me to be someone telling the story of the preacher or the teacher. And this idea of preacher or teacher, which is translated from the Hebrew word, and again, all of you language aficionados is what we're going to go with, know that this is not going to sound right to you, but it's Kohelet, which is the Hebrew word for someone who gathers people around and speaks to them. So it's typically translated preacher or teacher. So we have that is the naming used, but it's never directly named who it is in those contexts. And then we see that it is stated in the same verse that we looked at earlier, verse 1 through 3, that it is the son of David, king in Jerusalem. So that does, on the flip side, lend itself to sounding as if Solomon is possibly the author of the book. But I'd like for us to read a verse in chapter 1 together. I want to read verse 16 of chapter 1. Verse 16 of chapter 1 of Ecclesiastes says the following. I said in my heart, I have acquired great wisdom, surpassing all who were over Jerusalem before me, and my heart has had great experience of wisdom and knowledge. So it's this portion here of I have acquired great wisdom, surpassing all who were over Jerusalem before me, that I want us to think about for just a moment. Let's do a little biblical trivia. Which king moved the capital of the Israelite nation to Jerusalem? David. Before that, it was in Hebron when Saul was in power, I believe, and David moved the capital to Jerusalem. So this was a little bit tougher, but who is Solomon's dad? David, right? Okay, so David moved the capital to Jerusalem. So by my understanding, David is the one and only king who ruled over Jerusalem before Solomon. And the author says, or the speaker says, I have acquired great wisdom, surpassing all who were over Jerusalem before me. Now, first let me say that Solomon would be qualified to make that statement even in regards to his father. But the fact that he says all seems a little odd to me, considering David would have been one individual king in Jerusalem before Saul. And it seems like an odd way to describe being more intelligent and wise than your father. Now, doesn't mean that it couldn't have been done, but I just find it interesting that if it is, in fact, Solomon, or someone recounting Solomon's exact story, that would be recorded for us. But there's one final option that I've come across that I was not completely aware of before this, or at least not what it was called, and how it has been used more often throughout history than I was aware of. And there's a writing style that was common in the ancient Near East that is referred to as royal fictional biography. And so this writing style was common throughout all of the regions around Israel, and it likely could have bled into this region as a common writing style. And it's not so much to try and trick other people into thinking that, hey, I wrote this book and I want you to believe that Solomon wrote it, but it's more to be used as a means of effective writing and conveyance. For example, if 300 years from now somebody wanted to write a book on the culture and the aura and the inner workings of politics in America between 2005 and 2015, and they decided to write the book as if they were Barack Obama. Now, they're not trying to fool anybody 200 to 300 years from now into thinking that Barack Obama actually wrote that book, but they're using him as a character, given probably a lot of historical facts of things that he said and did and was witness doing, to explain to their current audience the temperature of the climate and all the different things that were going on at that time through that lens as a more effective way of writing. So I think that's also a possibility here, because if you were going to write this book of wisdom, this book that's going to perform this great life experiment, who would have been more well known at the time? Who would have had more resources at their disposal? Who would have clearly, as we know, had more wisdom than Solomon? And I would say that the answer to that would be no one. So it makes sense that if that were the way that this book was written, that Solomon was chosen to be the person who was personified in the text. But either way, whether Solomon wrote it, whether it's the author telling an exact account of Solomon's different experiences in life, or whether it's someone using the persona of Solomon, I think the fact that we know that the wisdom of Solomon is attributed and at least tied to this book, as it is other books of wisdom, which we'll talk about in just a little bit, helps in twofold. One, it helps us understand that somebody who had all of that at their disposal, what they ultimately came to understand is the meaning of life. But also, if we have these words recorded, and especially throughout previous history, given that Ecclesiastes and other books in the wisdom literature are sort of outside of the story of God's people, and they're pulled out as a different type of text than playing a part of the story, then I think that when it's attributed to Solomon in some shape, form, or fashion, who has traditionally throughout secular history as well been considered as wise and one of the most powerful and rich people to ever live, that this would give validity to this book as a sort of guide to understanding how life's supposed to work to those who have not yet become followers of God. And I think that that is why that essentially the authorship being either directly his or attributed to him is important. Yes, ma'am.
Drawbacks and pitfalls and perils of being rich and raised in the way that he was raised. And he is setting us up with this book to say, I've been there, done it. Now I want to tell you guys not to go there and do it.
Yeah.
That's what I'm picking up when I read. It's an older Solomon that is doing this, because he's had all this experience, all this wisdom, all this power, privilege, and it didn't work so well when he was younger. Now I'm telling you that I'm an old man. I can look back and see it, and I don't want you to fall into the same pitfall that I did. So here you go.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to try to paraphrase what Miss Vanessa just said, and I'll never do it justice. But she said, basically, it's her understanding that the author of Ecclesiastes is an older Solomon, a Solomon who has, even though we traditionally think of Solomon because of a lot of his exploits as a young man, that the author of Solomon or the author of Ecclesiastes, excuse me, is an older Solomon, a Solomon who has lived this life and has lived a life of many blessings, but then also he's fallen into the pitfalls of a lot of curses due to those blessings, due to the way that he exploited them. And he's telling us, listen, I've been there, I've done this, and I'm trying to persuade you not to make the same mistakes that I've had. So thank you very much. Oh, I'm not going to say that. No. So before we move on, is there anything else in regards to authorship that anyone would like to ask about or comment on? All right, so let's move on and talk about Ecclesiastes as a part of the wisdom literature. The wisdom literature as a whole and the role that Ecclesiastes plays in conjunction as a separate entity inside of the wisdom literature. So, when I consider the wisdom literature, I personally think of three specific books in the Old Testament. So, obviously, Ecclesiastes is one of those. What do you think the other two are? Proverbs, Song of Solomon, I heard Psalms, heard Job. So, for this particular class and the way they work together, I consider the three wisdom books that we're going to talk about tonight to be Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and the book of Job. And we'll see how they work together and explain why I feel that way. And we will look at it together. So, as I said, for this purpose, it's one of these three wisdom literature works, the other two being Proverbs and Job. And at times, it does play a negative role. But I think we're going to see that it plays a negative role to a positive outcome for us, to a positive outlook that we can have. So, with these three books, the first thing, alluded to it earlier, but one of the first things that jumps out to me is that these three books are outside, in a sense, of the story of God's people, what we typically see in our Old Testament. The majority of our Old Testament is the story of, really, of God's people becoming God's people and the physical and spiritual journey it takes to get there, and then them falling in and out of favor with God and the physical and spiritual battles that ensue from that. But these books are different. They're not a part of that narrative. They are sort of separate in the fact that they really don't even reference, other than a few places like we saw in Ecclesiastes, and the even being in Israel or certain things. They don't mention specific things that happen. But what they do is they shed light through different type of teachings on a world and how we are to act in that world and how that world is going to treat us within the same worldview of the Israelite nation, right? They believe in the same God. They're talking about serving the same God, obviously, as we know from them being all in the same Bible, but it's done through a much different light. It's not a part of the story that God is, and God's plan, excuse me, to ultimately save mankind, but it's more along the lines of, hey, these are things that I can highlight to you on an individual level that are going to show you how to act and react to the world while being a part of that overall story. And so while we're not seeing stories of other people that are just historical figures throughout the Bible listening and following God, or not listening to and not following God, and what God says about that and God's character being revealed to us, this is teaching us more specifically about our time and the circumstances in our individual lives that we are going to come into. And it ultimately, to me, it seems that it does that through passing on the wisdom of experienced, so to speak, God-fearing individuals. And each of these three books does it in a slightly different way, And when we think about these three books, I mentioned that I believe that they work as a whole to an extent, and I know that we're studying the book of Ecclesiastes in this class, and I think it's a wonderful book to study on its own. It's actually one of my favorites. However, I would tell you that when you're taking the time to read Ecclesiastes, I would try to set some time to study the book of Proverbs and the book of Job alongside it. And we're going to refer to both of those books pretty regularly throughout this class and see how they work together in this dynamic that we're going to talk about here for the next few minutes. They, in conjunction with one another, they sort of answer, in my mind, three questions. We see a lot of information on what it is to live a good life. We see a lot of information, even more specifically, to what it is to live a good life in this world that is created by God and shared with us by God. But then it also looks at and answers the question, what do you do when life doesn't seem to be working out? And the reason I particularly enjoy the book of Ecclesiastes is it is going to sort of bridge the gap between the other two and sort of explain the differences in the other two books. We're going to see throughout the text of Ecclesiastes wisdom in regards to building a better life by the means of building better relationships, better healthy lifestyles, being wise, but ultimately what those things mean in the grand picture of things and where they should fall in our priority list and how we use them to serve our ultimate purpose. And I think it's interesting when we look at the wisdom books as a whole and specifically any one of them individually. Throughout the other portions of the Old Testament, the biblical story of God's people we were talking about, the Bible, we're getting the revelation of God's character to us and how he loves his people, how he loves the world that he has created, and the way that the people have let him down and how that makes him feel. We see how people are able to overcome their shortcomings to God and how he is generous with them in that way. But it's always through the affirmations of these things happening in someone else's life or direct quotes from God, either by Moses or some of the prophets, for example, when they say things such as, "Thus saith the Lord." But what's really interesting to me about the wisdom literature is, for example, in Proverbs, we get a lot of this wisdom imparted on us as if it's a father giving his son life advice. In the book of Ecclesiastes, we're going to see a lot of this wisdom come to us from someone recounting this experiment of what you should or should not do and what's important on this life here, during this life on this earth. And then in Job, we have this perspective of what it means to have your whole world shaken through unbearable and almost unimaginable personal tragedy. So all of these books bring us this information and bring us this wisdom, as I said, on a more individual level. So let's talk about each one of them briefly. The book of Proverbs, as I said up there, it almost comes across as, you know, do good and prosper and enjoy life. Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 8 says, "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths." That sounds pretty good. "Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord, and turn away from evil. It will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones." I mean, that's almost saying, you know, whether you're on the chewable Flintstones end of the spectrum or the Centrum Silver end of the spectrum, we can throw the multivitamins away, because if you do this, if you live this way, things are going to be good for you. In Proverbs 13 and 9, we see it stated sort of a different way. "The light of the righteous rejoices, but the lamp of the wicked will be put out." We see the same concept reiterated in the 24th chapter of Proverbs. "For the evil man has no future, the lamp of the wicked will be put out." while the book of Proverbs is a very positive book, and it's a very obviously worthwhile book, the thing that I constantly have to remind myself of when I'm reading it and when I study it is that Proverbs are exactly what these are, right? They are proverbs and not promises. They're general outcomes of if you live wise in this manner, then generally life will work out this way. And that's what we see here in the book of Proverbs on the few examples that we pulled up. When referring to the evil man who has no future and the lamp of the wicked will be put out, the book of Job is going to ask us, really, is that how it goes? In Job 21, verse 17, he says, how often is that the lamp of the wicked is put out? That their calamity comes upon them. So Job is in the middle of his trials. He's asking the exact opposite thing, or trying to have confirmation what the book of Proverbs is telling us. So they're almost at odds with one another, at least if you're looking at them on an individual basis. But when we study Ecclesiastes, I think we're going to see that Ecclesiastes tells us, I have witnessed it. I have witnessed what Job is expressing. I have witnessed what Proverbs is expressing. And while they can both be true, it's all Hevel. And the reason it's Hevel is because it doesn't always make sense to us. It is confusing, and it's beyond our current grasp. So during the majority of the book of Ecclesiastes, for instance, in chapter 7, I believe it says, I've seen a righteous man who dies and a wicked man with a long life. It's Hevel. But then he's also going to tell us in other places that it's better to live wisely than to live foolishly, much like the Proverbs tell us. It's all Hevel in the eyes of the Ecclesiastes speaker. It seems to me that the Proverbs point to the benefits of a life well lived. I think we would all agree that if you live wisely, if you attempt to maintain solid relationships and do your part in those relationships, if you attempt to live a healthy lifestyle, if you attempt to live ethically and justly, more often than not, things are going to go better for that person than someone who makes no attempt to live ethically, no attempt to live morally, that cheats and lies and steals. More often than not, the former of that situation is going to live a better life and have less things go wrong. However, we can look at Job and see that there is going to be an unfairness and an unjustness to life at times that we're not able to wrap our heads around because we've done the things that the book of Proverbs teaches us, and yet these things still fall upon us. And a side note real quickly, and I don't want this done during class, but I'm going to make a request. If anyone in here has any deeper knowledge than I do, which is not much on this one, about if Job was an Israelite or not, I would love to have that conversation with you outside of this class. I just kind of came across some new information to me on that the other day, and it's pretty fascinating. So if you would like to have that conversation with me outside of this class, please do. But, so, and Ecclesiastes is going to speak to the despair that we can have in this life, which comes from the situations like Job spoke to, or it comes from those, and also seeing the way that Proverbs says life can play out, and trying to make sense of why things go the way they go. The collection overall, this collection of wisdom literature, I believe, speaks to all of us at different seasons of our life with different portions of the text. And they work together to paint a picture of how life works, not contradictory to one another, but rather to show that we truly live in a fallen world. I believe that the collection of wisdom literature together is a sophisticated account of human experience, which we're going to get to enjoy reading through Ecclesiastes to see exactly what that means for us while we're here on this earth. And again, it highlights the individual experience while we play our part in the overall arcing story of God's people. Ecclesiastes is going to tell us in its wisdom that maybe we have the promises of life wrong and will proceed to put them in the proper perspective. And as a whole, the wisdom literature makes us develop a deep, true faith by highlighting the fact that things that happen in this life will make us have to doubt and then overcome that doubt. Things will cause us grievances and hardships, and that we cannot understand them. So ultimately, it highlights the fact that life is hevel. And the study of Ecclesiastes, in particular, will teach us how to spot the hevel in our lives and how to navigate just that hevel. Which brings us to having a short little conversation about this concept of hevel again before we begin on Sunday going through the text. So, actually, before I do that, did anybody have anything that they wanted to ask about or say in regards to Ecclesiastes as a piece of the wisdom literature or the wisdom literature as a whole? Okay, so this concept of hevel again. As I said last week, understanding of this term is key to our understanding of the book. It's used over 30 times throughout the book. It's often used in conjunction with the phrase under the sun to highlight the fact that our time here on earth is what is indeed hevel, and that it is hard for us to understand exactly what is always going on around us. So we read Ecclesiastes chapter 1 last week and again this week, and as you saw, my translation uses the term vanity in Ecclesiastes 1, 1 through 3. I believe someone last week had the translation of futile. Someone else had the translation of meaningless, which we see on the screen. And I think before we continue, just for the next couple moments talking about the different meanings of the word, it's just important to remember that just because a word has multiple different translations, and I know this is not new information to anyone, just something that I like to remind myself of from time to time, that the thought that goes along with that word in one language may not translate directly into a thought that is associated with the direct spelling translation, so to speak, in another language. You know, for example, if Don came over to me today and said, "Hey, Ryan, what day can you come help me carry some stuff out of my house? I need to load a truck." I would say, "I come on Tuesday," because, you know, Mondays are busy. But if I got over there and I was helping Don move this box on Tuesday, and we started talking about different things that we've done in our life, and I was explaining to him something that I like, and Don said, "Well, back in my day, we did this," then we got the same word used for two different variations of a meaning. So I just want to reiterate that the fact that it is definitely used in multiple ways in this, the same word, is something that's common to us even today. So then we have this metaphor that is used throughout the book, and it's the literal translation of the word hevel, which is smoke or vapor, something that is elusive, ungraspable, also mentioned to be striving after the wind. And we also have the second metaphor that's used, and I believe it's used more often in the book than any other meaning of the word hevel, and that is that something is enigmatic or a paradox, something that we will have a hard time wrapping our heads around, something that is hard for us to understand, actually something that sometimes it just won't make sense to us at all within the construct of our human mind, and these are things that we will be revealed later. So I have on the screen, is it truly suggesting that there is no meaning to life under the sun? I think that we will all agree that that's not the outcome that this author is coming to, but it's trying rather to explain to us how pursuits of this life, not being in the proper context, what they ultimately boil down to. But if you look at the last chapter of the book, In chapter 12, starting in verse 13, the author says the following: "The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil." So I think it's clear that, in conjunction especially with a couple of verses before that, that the author is not telling us that our existence is meaningless. It's just telling us that certain things in our existence are either meaningless or unattainable or unable to be understood right now. And that should, knowing that these things will be revealed later and the trivialness of some of these things, should push us to ultimately lead what is the only fulfilling life, the life following God and keeping his commandments. In other words, I think we're going to see that the book of Ecclesiastes is going to teach us to embrace the hevel, which is essentially embracing the unembraceable, right? But to embrace the hevel, to be able to recognize what is hevel, so that we can then shift our gaze and see beyond that hevel, as the title of our class suggests. So, just for the last minute or two that we have together, I wanted to talk for a minute about the goals that I have for our class. Not so much the mechanisms in which we'll view class, like we talked about last week, but this more pertaining to what I hope our outcomes are. So, I hope we can understand what the preacher says to be meaningless, and as I just mentioned, learn to embrace the hevel. And I think there are three main perspectives that we're going to end up doing that through that we'll find in the text. At least that's how I typically see them. It's going to be, are we in control versus, or who is ultimately in control of a certain situation? The idea of gift versus gain. And then probably the view that I'll use, we'll look through the most, will be this: living with the end in sight. So looking at our pending demise, but using that to give us comfort in the things that we don't understand in the here and now, and helping us to enjoy the life that we have in the here and now, whether it all makes sense to us or not. So I'll just leave you with this. It's a quote I found that I like. It sort of sums up the way I view the book. It says, "Ecclesiastes is essentially a kind of negative theologian. He's asking questions that can be answered only by a future revelation of God. In clearing the road for this revelation, he smashes any and all false hopes to pieces. Ecclesiastes is the Bible's night before Christmas. Ecclesiastes is human self-sufficiency stretched to its absolute limit and found sadly wanting." Thank you again for being here tonight, and we will see each other on Sunday.
all four verses of Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Good to see all of you tonight. Just a few announcements before we have a song and prayer and are dismissed. There were two people that we were praying for to have successful surgery this week. Dale Looper did have successful surgery. We're very excited for that. Very thankful that he came through. He had a very long, extensive surgery. As well as Don's friend Steve in Indiana, who's a former member here. He went through his surgery very well as well. So prayers of thanksgiving are in order for that. We have two surgeries that are coming up this week that you need to be praying for. Tomorrow morning, Paulette Kreider-Jenkins is going to have surgery, so make sure you pray for her that all that goes smoothly. And little Hunter Solens, he's going to have a quick surgery on Friday at St. Joe's. He needs to update his G-tube, and the Solens report that it should be simple, easy, and he should be home later on that day. So please pray that his surgery goes exactly that way. I want to make sure that you're aware that this Saturday, there's going to be a funeral for Simeon Brown. That is Mary Williams' stepfather. There's going to be a visitation at 10 a.m. and a funeral at 11 a.m. That's going to be at Harmon Funeral Home Chapel. So make sure that if you can be there to support our dear sister in her loss, that you are there. And finally, I want to remind you that this Sunday, we're going to have picture day. So if you need to update your picture, make sure you dress appropriately and get back there after services so you can make sure we all know what you look like now. Those are all the announcements I have. You'll be standing. We'll have a song of prayer and be dismissed.
Oh, Let's pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for another day that we can come and worship you. Thank you for your son's sacrifice and how much that means to us to have the opportunity to go to heaven. Help us to be kind-hearted to others in the world, and help us to shine our lights and be that example we need to be in this world of hatred and anger, and help us to stand for the truth, knowing that there's so many false teachers out there. Help us to be that light we need to be to stand up for what we believe in. Be with us as we depart. Help us to continually grow in your word, and help us to come back and be a stronger Christian. In Jesus' name, amen.